The question that we will be getting in the next few days is, how was your Christmas? Right? How was your Christmas? It is the question that we will get in the next coming days or weeks or so. And while I understand what is being asked, I also hear an underlying assumption that Christmas is over. It is the same assumption that underlies the birthday wishes to Jesus. Happy birthday, Jesus, suggests that Christmas is the celebration of a past event, an anniversary. It is the reason why in a few days, in some homes, the tree will be immediately taken down, the decorations packed away for another year, and of course, the leftovers of all those food will be thrown out. Now, I raise these points not as a criticism or judgment to our culture, but to see it diagnostically, in recognition that we are event-driven people. We are event-driven people. We tend to live our lives from one event to another. If you don't think so, take a look at your calendar. Take a look at your Google Calendar, because it is full of events. It is a schedule of events. Our days are full of events, and if there's a day or two with no scheduled events, then we say things like, oh, there's nothing going on that day. Or, I'm not doing anything that day. As if a day with no events has nothing. And there's nothing to learn or discover from a day that has no event. Nothing to experience on those days. But how different is John's understanding of Christmas, of life, and of humanity, which we'll read in a second from our text this Christmas day, which is John 1, 1 to 14. It is the text where we will hear the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen His glory. And so this morning received the reading as such by saying, thanks be to God, after I finish the reading. John 1, 1 to 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through Him, and without Him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in Him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or the will of the flesh, or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. This is the Word of the Lord. Let us pray. Grant us one thing, O Lord, that the meditation of our heart will give us an encounter with the living Word Himself, the one whose birth we celebrated, and the one whose manifesting continuously in our heart we seek to continue to happen each and every day. In His name we pray. Amen. What comes to mind when you think about the work of Christmas? What comes to mind when you think about the work of Christmas? For most of us, I suspect it's things like shopping, right? Or wrapping presents, or decorating, or cleaning the house, or buying groceries and cooking Christmas meals. For most of us, it's getting ready for Santa and opening presents, right? I know the kids are excited to do that later today. Or it's getting to church on time for the start of the Christmas service. I know for some, it's a lot of work just getting through these days. They are hard days of grief, sadness, depression. I have a friend who just lost his mother yesterday, late last night, and he has to preach a message this morning. For some, the work includes planning the worship service and preparing sermons, people in our line of work. We do a lot of work leading up to and in anticipation of Christmas Day. And I wouldn't be a bit surprised if later on this Christmas Day, after the child has been born and after the dishes have been done, there's this collective sigh of relief. Our Christmas work is done. Our Christmas work is over. But what if it's really not over? What if that's when the work of Christmas begins? That's when the Christian theologian, mystic, and poet by the name of Howard Thurman writes in his poem entitled, The Work of Christmas. The Work of Christmas. Let me read it for you. It goes, when the song of the angels is stilled, when the star in the sky is gone, when the kings and the princes are home, when the shepherds are back with their flock, the work of Christmas begins. To find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among brothers, to make music in the heart. Have you ever thought that maybe the work of Christmas is what it means and looks like for the Word to become flesh and live among us? Maybe the Word becoming flesh and living among us is a momentary kind of thing happening only in the moments when the work of Christmas is being done. Maybe it's less about a particular person and more about a way of being and living with each other. I think most of us hear about the Word becoming flesh and living among us, and we immediately assume it's about Jesus. And I don't disagree with that. It is about Jesus. What happened in Bethlehem was that the Word became flesh. The Word became what the Word was not. God became what God was not. And I don't know how to say that any better. I don't know any other way to put it. It is mind-boggling that God becomes one of us. The one by whom all things were made become one of the all things. The one by whom flesh was made became flesh. The one who made human beings became a human being. This God that we follow, that we claim to be found in Jesus Christ, is so secure that he's able to change and not be afraid. God is so secure in being God that he's able to come in the form of a little baby and trust himself to the care of this young girl, Mary. God is so secure that he can be that humble, became flesh. And that is why the central act of Christian worship that we will do later is the Lord's Supper, the Eucharist. It involves these very tangible elements. Bread, wine, symbolizes flesh and blood, the very thing that he has become. And then we see him enfleshing, that is making real the Word of God throughout his life. Enfleshing through forgiveness, through love, through mercy, through peace, through gentleness, through nonviolence, through wisdom, through compassion, through generosity. That was his way of being and living. And so, yes, I do think the Word became flesh in Jesus. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory. The glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. The central point of the Gospel of John is that what we read earlier. It celebrates the most astonishing event in history, the Word becoming flesh, the Word who was there in the beginning, even before the beginning, the one before all things were made, and without him, there is nothing that was made. The Creator of all things became a human and lived as one of us in the midst of all our brokenness, our mess, our sadness, and our sorrow. Now, before going further as to how this text is related to our work of Christmas, I want to invite you to reflect on one of the things that will help us see the importance of our work of Christmas. Have you ever wondered why does John tell this amazing event in history by putting the emphasis in the phrase, "We have seen his glory"? We have seen his glory. And the word became flesh and we have seen his glory. Why did he not say something like, "The word became flesh and dwelt among us and God and humanity were reconciled"? Because that is the implication of the good news of Jesus Christ, right? Or like, "The word became flesh and dwelt among us and destroyed the rule of Satan." And that is the great fact of the gospel. Satan has lost his rule. Or another example, why did he not say, "The word became flesh and dwelt among us and the power of sin and death were defeated"? That is the fact of the resurrection. All of these are great implications of the result of the coming of the word in our flesh. Why not emphasize these things? Why emphasize glory? Why emphasize, "And we have seen his glory"? I think John emphasizes that as the great implication of the coming of the word, because to see glory is in fact our greatest and deepest need. There's a saying that is attributed to Saint Irenaeus: the glory of God is a human being fully alive. The glory of God is a human being fully alive. We need to see glory so that we can see what it means to be a human being fully alive. We need to see Christ so that we can be the glorious human being fully alive, modeled after the glorious human being who ever lived. And so, yes, I do think the word became flesh in Jesus, but I just don't think it is unique or exclusive to Jesus. And that is good news for us. Because if Jesus is the only one to whom the word became flesh and can become flesh, then why bother inviting us to join and participate in the work that he's doing? And so Jesus is also inviting us to become word becoming flesh. And so the question for us is, what about you and me? What about this word becoming flesh in us? I believe God sees humanity as the opportunity and the means to reveal himself. Let me say that again, because we often don't get it. I believe God sees humanity as the opportunity and the means to reveal God's self. That is what we see in Jesus Christ, right? Yet too far often, we use our humanity as an excuse. "I'm only human." How often we say that when we fail? We tripped, we stumble, and we say, "I'm only human." And we declare as if we are somehow deficient. We fail to see, we fail to believe, we fail to understand that in the word becoming flesh and living among us, we are also God's sacrament, God's way of revealing God's self. Human beings, you and I, are the tangible, the outward, and the visible signs and carriers of God's inward and spiritual presence. Have you ever thought of yourself that way? That you are the tangible, outward, and visible signs and carriers of God's inward and spiritual presence. That wherever we go, it is holy ground. Not to put us in a position to puff ourselves up, but actually to humble ourselves, because we are held up to such a high standard. Have you ever thought of yourself as a sacrament? Have you ever looked at someone across the street and said, "Hey, look, that is God's manifestation. That is God's sacrament," because that is a sacramental image of God. I know I fail all the time to see that. But why do we not see that in ourselves? Why do we not see that in each other? After all, the Word became flesh and lived among us. And so I believe the Word can and is intended to become flesh in us to the same degree it was in Jesus. And I believe that happens every time we offer compassion, we offer mercy, and in every moment when we do the work of Christmas. Have you ever loved or forgiven another person? Have you ever reached out to another with compassion and gentleness? Have you ever responded to another person with nonviolence and peace? Have you ever fed the hungry or cared for the sick? Has someone else ever done those things to you or for you? If you answered yes to any of those questions, then you can also say, and once again, the Word became flesh and lived among us. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And the Word became flesh and has never ceased living among us. The Word became flesh and will never cease living among us. And so the challenge for us this Christmas day is this: make way. Make way. Wherever you go, whatever you are doing, whoever you are with, make way for the image of God. Christmas your way through life by becoming the Word became flesh. It's Christmas, and the song of the angels is stilled. The star in the sky is gone. The kings and the princes are home, and the shepherds are back with their flock. So what about you and me? What about you and me? Where do we go from here? What's next for us? Well, I say Merry Christmas. And I say it's time to do the work of Christmas. There's a Word of God desiring to become flesh in you and me. And so our work of Christmas begins, and that is to find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among brothers, and finally, to make music in the heart. Merry Christmas, everybody. Let's bow our heads. Lord Jesus, in whatever circumstances we find ourselves in today, whether we are full of joy or maybe there's something that is troubling our heart, whether we are reminded of something that has caused us sorrow, or whether we are full of thanksgiving, let us begin the work of Christmas by beginning to make music in our heart, so that we can offer you thanksgiving. And from a posture of thanksgiving, we can do all the things that you're calling us to do as Word becoming flesh, following you one step at a time, each and every day, Christmasing our way through this life, recognizing the grand beauty that you are calling us into. Our humanity is never an excuse for failure. Our humanity is actually an excuse for glory, because you have made us in your image. Allow us to just live that out each and every day. With the help of your Spirit, we pray and give thanks. Amen.